really excited to have you here tonight. We've been doing these every week, and they just keep getting better. And so this week we have, I just put this up here. If you're not already part of our newsletter, please sign up. We'd love to keep you informed as to the exhibitions we do and the artist talks and any exciting news, like, I don't know, buying a building down the street. You'll be the first to know if you're on our newsletter. Tonight we have Veronica Melendez and Juan Madrid, who is former CPW staff. So we're really excited to have Juan back and have Veronica here as well. I'm going to read a bio. I think we're starting off with Veronica, so we'll start there. Veronica Melendez is a photographer, illustrator, and curator based between Washington, D.C. and Troy, New York. She's the founder of La Horchata, an arts publication highlighting creatives from the Central American diaspora. She was selected for the 2018 Archive of Documentary Arts Collection Award for Documentarians of the American South by David M. Rubenstein Rare Book and Manuscript Library at Duke University. And her work has been featured in the Washington Post, NPR, Vice, and Hyperallergenic, among others. Her arts publication, La Horchata, which you can see over here, has been exhibited at the Museum of Latin American Art in Long Beach, California, and the inaugural exhibition Presente, is that right? In the Molina Family Latino Gallery at the National Museum of American History. She received a BFA from the Corcoran College of Art and Design and MFA from the University of Hartford. She is currently the technical instructor of photography at Bennington College. Let's welcome Veronica, please.
Hi, good evening. I wanted to say just a thank you to CPW, first of all, for hosting these talks, and also thank you to Sarah and Juan for including me in the programming tonight. I really appreciate it. I moved to Troy, New York from Washington, D.C. about 2 years ago, and so I'm still like newish to the area, and I just really am thankful to be sharing space with you all tonight, and like finding like photography community in upstate New York is really meaningful for me. Anyway, so my name is Veronica Melendez, and I'm a visual artist and diaspora zine maker and educator. I was born and raised in Washington, D.C., and I wanted to start off this talk sharing one of my first bodies of work, which had a very lasting impact on who I am as an artist and is a good introduction into my work. So this project is called Le Pido a Dios que no me olviden, which translates to I ask God that they don't forget me. The base of this project comes from my experiences growing up around my mother's family. My mother is from Guatemala, and she migrated to the U.S. in the early 80s as an 18-year-old. When she came to the U.S., she came with my grandmother and five of her sisters. There's eight of them in total. She brought with her this little journal that inside of it were all these goodbye letters from all her relatives and like best friends and loved ones. And it's something that she's carried with her throughout her whole life. And when she had me, it was just always around. And I even would like try to steal it and use it as a coloring book sometimes. And she would get really upset at me for it. But once I got older and I started like actually appreciating this as an object and reading these letters, I started finding like these really little pieces of gems that really have inspired like most of everything that I've created as an adult person. In one of these pages in these letters is where I found the title to this project, which is Le Pido a Dios que no me olviden. It was my great uncle wrote this goodbye letter to her, essentially just like asking God that they wouldn't forget him, that they all wouldn't forget him. And this like really resonated to me, and just the thought of like saying goodbye to somebody and not knowing whether you'll ever see them again is like almost hard to like grasp now, especially with all of us just carrying around little internets in our pockets. And so, yeah, it just like really like resonated with me. And it just felt as if he was saying goodbye to them in a way that they were jumping into the void and never to be seen or heard from again. And that really inspired me to make this work. And essentially the base of this project is documenting the Central American community that I grew up in Washington, D.C. And while I was working on this project, I felt like I had discovered how to look at my surroundings in a different way. And as cheesy as it sounds, it felt like everything was so beautiful and interesting in a very new way, just like looking at everything through my camera. like moments that otherwise would have felt totally normal were now stopping in my tracks. And I was just like noticing the uniqueness of like the everyday that I lived in. Like Washington DC is very special for many reasons, but to me, there's just such an intense like Central American community that exists in Washington DC that I think is unlike anything else in the rest of this country. You know, like the high school I went to, 80% of the high school is from El Salvador. And I feel like that's a very unique thing to the suburbs of DC. And that was my normal, and it's not really everyone else's normal, especially in the diaspora of Central Americans. It's not everyone else's experience. And that's not something I realized right away growing up in it, because I was in the thick of it. And it wasn't until I went to college and I started making this kind of work that I realized, oh, this is actually something really special. And something that like I almost felt responsible to document. And so in this project, I felt like I was kind of on fire and I was just like photographing everything, like super, like just like nothing was like off limits. And I would photograph my family gatherings. I'd photograph my mother's church, which was in an old bowling alley. And just like everything was just something that felt super interesting and unique to me. And I just wanted to share it with everybody else and show them how we've created home in Washington, D.C. So yeah, I just felt like a responsibility to make photographs of my community and not just tell our story, but to also visually archive, especially with D.C. being like a place that's been aggressively gentrifying for most of my life. I felt like I wanted to make a sort of like a stamp that like, hey, we're here and this is our home. And this is how home looks like to us. This is our perseverance and community and strength and beauty and joy in the everyday. Like just existing in Washington, D.C. as a collective, just diaspora, is a form of resistance, in like my opinion. And so, yeah, I just like started photographing everything and trying almost in a way to try to make sense of my own surroundings as like a young person, just discovering all of this and what I had been living in my whole life. So I would photograph stores, tiendas latinas, so we call them there, my grandmother's house. Like my whole family just got super used to me like shoving a camera in their face and they just like stopped caring at this point. They're like, oh yeah, there goes Veronica again, just photographing us like in every occasion that we had. And so like this project is technically completed, but it still feels like I can jump back into it at any moment. Like there's like different chapters that need to be made of it. This is like a snapshot in time, and I think it's really special that it's archived in this way. And a lot of these neighborhoods have changed a lot since I made this project. Like some of them are like a bit unrecognizable at this point, but the Central American community is still there and it's growing and it's thriving. And this is the where the church is in the basement of this like arcade bowling alley, which is still there. So a lot of these photos were made in DC, but also in the suburbs in Northern Virginia and in Maryland. So we're talking about places like Wheaton, Maryland, Silver Spring, Alexandria, Falls Church in Virginia. And also just to mention, this body of work was selected for the 2018 Archive of Documentary Arts Collection Award for Documentarians in the American South. And a set of prints of like this project has been archived in the Duke University's Rare Book and Manuscript Library. I feel like it's something special just to mention that, you know, this set of images will like remain in existence beyond me and everything. And it's just nice to know they're being like archived on a proper manner somewhere, physically, not just like a digital file. And so from that, I wanted to shift into talking about La Huerchata, which is the arts publication that me and my friend Kimberly Benavides both founded. It's an arts publication that features artists from the Central American diaspora and from Central America. And we don't use themes. We include all mediums from painting, photography, poetry, short story, and even video pieces and music with the use of QR codes. I think here you can see. Mm-hmm. And we founded this magazine in 2017, and it came out of wanting to make space for ourselves in the printed arts world. We felt there wasn't much representation for Central Americans at the time. And instead of waiting for someone to make that happen, we decided to do it ourselves. So we bought a small Xerox printer and asked a handful of our closest friends to submit their artwork, essentially like begged them to submit their artwork to something that was like totally new. And we made the first issue. I think there was like 9 artists in the first issue, including ourselves. And by the second issue, we had over 100 submissions from all across the US to be part of this like little arts publication. And it was all just from word of mouth through social media. And we were like absolutely surprised to see it grow so much from one issue to the next. We hesitated in starting this publication for a while because we weren't sure there would be an audience for it. We kind of convinced ourselves that it was just like us that wanted this. But it turns out there was like this huge community of diaspora artists from Central American diaspora out there also wanting something like this to exist. So after the second issue, we moved away from self-printing and we started sending it out to get it printed to keep up with demand. And each issue has grown slightly, and in the amount of artists we include has also grown slightly. And so the community that we've been building virtually through the scene has also grown as well. And yeah, so we were so wrong about there not being a community that wanted this. And in this past year, we published issue number 9, and we've sent out over close to 200 issues of that of number 9. So it's still definitely like thriving as a publication. We hope to continue it and maybe take it into another direction and grow it even further. And our latest issues also started to include diaspora outside of the US. So we have people from the UK, from the Czech Republic, from I think also Australia. We have people from diaspora living in Uruguay who have sent us artwork. Like people from all over the place have started sending us artwork as well. So yeah, we're just sort of building community beyond the US and beyond Central America as well. And you can see here, like this is kind of how we started, just folding all the issues. I think we folded over 100 like that. And then we're like, after the second issue of doing that, our Xerox printer just like, it gave up on us. And then we're like, okay, it's time. It's time to move on from that. And yeah, and I have the first issue here, if anybody wants to see it later. And this is the second issue. And then from that, we ended up sending it out to get printed. And this is the first one that we had that existed in a different format. And I also wanted to just mention that, you know, because of the zine and the community that we started building, we've been able to do all these events, community events in DC and in other places as well. But we've also had the opportunity to bring some of this artwork into the gallery spaces, into predominantly white spaces. And in 2019 and 2020, I curated a show at Duke University and at the University of Maryland that featured artists from this community. And it was the first time that there was ever an exhibit in these institutions that solely featured artists from the Central American diaspora. And I'm currently in talks with an institution that's closer to here that we're hoping to move the exhibit to. So that'll happen soon, hopefully. And here's an image just from one of the installations at the University of Maryland. And you can see we have paintings, we have photographs, printmaking, sculpture, ceramics, like all sorts of things. And this is a cover from one of our latest zines. This one took us almost 2 years to finish because we started it in 2019 and the pandemic hit. And then like a year went by, I feel like we blinked and it was a year later. And then we finally released it. But with this issue, we were able to start making it a little bit larger and including even more artists in it. So we went from this to this one. So it's just slightly bigger, but thicker as well. Just a lot more artists, a lot more content. We started including video pieces through QR codes and music videos. And there were artists from Central America featured in this one as well. And this one is our latest issue. And it was really special for us because both Kimberly and myself are photographers. Like that's what we studied. And so we finally gave ourselves permission to make an issue that just featured photographers from the diaspora, which we felt like we weren't allowed to do for some reason this whole time. So this one's that one. So it's just photography in this one, which I think is really special. And there's also a couple of interviews as well. And we included our own artwork in it too, which we hadn't done since the first issue. And I have some copies here today, if anybody wants one. So now I'm going to shift back to my photography and talk about a project that I've been slowly etching away at since 2019. This project is called Las Ocho Hijas de Olivia, which translates to the Eight Daughters of Olivia. And Olivia is my grandmother, and she had eight daughters. And they all migrated here to the U.S. Around the 80s, 90s, and early 2000s. And they all ended up moving to Washington, D.C. and in Maryland. So I grew up in that kind of like a big family. Like I have close to 30 first cousins just on my mother's side. And this project was inspired just by hearing their different migration stories. And I wanted to sort of like archive and document and record all of their individual migration stories that I felt like if I didn't do it, then they would just be lost into the ether and no one will know about it. And our future generations won't know how we ended up living in the United States. And I originally started off wanting this to be a photo book. And I was like very focused on like, it's gonna be a photo book and that can't be anything else. Like I had blinders on. But that's how I started the project. And now I feel like it's shifted into, I'm open to it being anything really, even a video piece maybe, who knows? I feel like the pandemic hit and I was like, oh, I can do anything now. I'm not just a photographer. But yeah, so when I started this project, I would visit all my aunts and I would go there after work and I would with the intention of photographing them and it would usually be in the evenings and I'd end up being fed, like they'd be cooking dinner and I'd end up staying and then we'd just all have dinner. And it was a sort of like little ritual that I was doing with my aunts like one at a time and just like catching up and hearing about their own stories. And so I wanted this book to include like archival family images, some text and ephemera, and my own photographs as well. And yeah, so this project is still going on, but with the pandemic, it definitely paused things. And I also moved away from DC, which makes it difficult to continue. And during this time, a lot of my aunts have also moved away from DC. So yeah, the project is still taking shape in different ways, but it's definitely still in my imagination. And so, yeah, since I moved away from DC, I've been revisiting a lot of this work and allowing myself to be a bit more experimental with it. And I started doing things like this, which has actually been inspired by a lot of the students I work with at Bennington College, just seeing how free they are with their own photography to just using their images in any sort of way. Like 8 years post grad school, I feel like I'm still learning to like loosen up and like allow myself to do things like this, which isn't even that crazy, but to me it's like, oh my God. So this image is a card I found behind a photograph in an old photo album that my grandfather left in a shoebox. It's of the Guatemalan embassy. It's like a sort of like an appointment card to go to the Guatemalan embassy in Washington, D.C. From 1978. And behind it is an image of a lake that's in the highlands of Guatemala called Lago Atitlan. And yeah, a lot of these images like are these very like lovely, intimate, nurturing moments that I had with my aunts. And so I'm still trying to find a balance on exactly how to tell their stories. And I've also started photographing my cousins and their children for this project. Because my grandmother really helped raise all of us in a sense. We're like all her children. And I was also able to go to Guatemala and make some images with this project in mind. It's something I hope to do in the future again. Now that I feel like this project is moving into a different direction, I started playing around with using some of these images with the images of my aunts living in the US. And I hope to go back and photograph like around the neighborhood that they grew up in. So this image is also from Guatemala. And this image is actually from the lake pictured in that previous photo. It's a boat that goes to the different villages around the lake. And so this image, you can see a little page here. And this is torn out of the book that I referenced in the beginning that was sort of the inspiration to that first project I shared. You can see the handwriting and the name at the bottom. This is the person who like wrote this letter to my mother. And if you read Spanish, you can read that it's a very like intimate and touching and heartfelt letter, just sort of again saying goodbye as if they might never ever see each other ever again. And the image on the other side is an image of my mother when she first came to DC, and it was her first snowfall that she experienced here. And the background is of an image on the top of walking up a volcano looking out in the landscape in Guatemala. So with this project, I'm hoping to do more things like this and maybe incorporate some like recordings of them telling their own stories. And it's okay. No, it's totally fine. Okay, so I have like two more projects I wanted to just briefly share. I mentioned that I was used to making a lot of work living in DC my whole life. I moved there only two years ago. And I've sort of been sort of like a reckoning to my own artistic practice. I was so used to being immersed in all the content that brought inspiration to me, and then just like plucking myself away from it. It's been really eye-opening to be so much more intentional about making artwork. It's not something I was used to. I feel like I would just like go outside and be like immediately inspired, or go visit my family and it just be like so much like content, you know, that I wanted to make photographs from. And so now living all the way up here, also not living in a Central American community, wasn't something that I was used to either. And this project was sort of the first time I allowed myself to sort of like break away from just making artwork about my family. And I was able to do a sort of workshop at the Secret Rizzo Press in Brooklyn. They have a Rizzograph zine workshop. And so I went there with my photographs, and we were able to put it together in a zine and print it through the Rizzograph. And all these images were made after I had moved from DC. So while I was living up here, and so this is a very special project for me. I'm going to...
De las alas de topes para recuperarme. Ya te vi aquí de rodillas queriendo volver a besarme. Pero ni aunque reces diario, te alcanza para perdonarte. Y chingo a mi madre si cuando vuelvas no te mando a chingar mucho a tu madre. Chingo a mi madre si no te reemplazo en menos de 15
So this project, the title of the zine, the little book, is called Goddamn Zoo. And it sort of touches on my relationship of being in romantic relationships with white men. So that's just a little bit of what it touches on. And I also have this zine here as well, if anybody wants one. And I also just wanted to mention that I'm also an illustrator. It's something I got into after grad school. I needed to like do something completely different for like 3 years before I returned to photography. And I just started making illustrations as well. And the covers for La Bachata zine are all illustrated by me. So these little guys. And the last thing I wanted to share was, I feel like a good stopping point as to like where my work is headed. It sort of mixes my illustrations, my interest in photography, but also this like ever-present need to like make artwork about where I come from and the diaspora and all those things combined. And the bird you see here is a quetzal, which is the national bird of Guatemala. It's also the name of the currency as well. And the images you're gonna see are from Google Street View. They're screenshots of my mother's, of the neighborhood my mother grew up in Guatemala. And the voice you'll hear is of my grandmother. She's like super excited and marveling at the snow from a blizzard in 1996. And she's like speaking, it's audio from a camcorder that that she was walking around filming, thinking she was filming the snow, but she was actually just filming the sky most of the time. And she was just talking into the camcorder as if she was making like a video for everybody back home to talk to them about the snow. And I don't think this video still exists with me, like no one else has seen it. But she was just talking into it like, this is like, I must show all these people all the snow that fell here. It's so amazing. So this is the audio that you'll hear with this. Maybe.
She created Instagram live.
Yeah, she did.
Aquí vamos rumbo a la casa de Araceli. Mañana tenemos aniversario de haber venido, 20 años de haber venido a este país, casi lo mismo que nos atrasaron el vuelo por el día de hoy. Así está hoy cerrado. Así es que...
Aquí está cerrado para arriba.
Para abajo. Ah, a ver qué va a salir. Mira qué camioneta. Parece pastelito, me dan ganas de comer. Ya me están dando ganas de café con pastel. Ojalá aquí quisiera tener a mi nieto jugando aquí en esta nieve. Está bien bonito, ahorita no hay mucho frío, pero mañana.
No suba tanto para que miren bien.
Yo quería tomar este video para que vea también la gente de que Dios todo lo puede. Ya mañana a trabajar.
Yeah, she like ends that video by saying, and tomorrow back to work. Cool. So that's all I have to share with you all today. I think we're doing a Q&A. Maybe.
Hi. So I was just, and by the way, this is too personal, you know, I understand, but I was just wondering how your family ended up in the air in both places. You know? And I'm asking you because I also, my team ended up in the air.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so what's up there?
I'm not entirely sure, but I know that they're in D.C. There is a bodega, like a tienda latina there that has been there since the 60s, which is like pretty old. And I know a lot of people came to Mount Pleasant specifically because they knew that that's like kind of where they could get pieces of home, like food. So people would just go there and like find, you know, postings for places to live. And rent, and they knew that they could go there and find community. I can't tell you exactly who was the first person to go there, but specifically for me, my grandfather came to the U.S. much earlier than my mother's family, and my mother as well. He was out here like working, and it was back when you could actually get sponsored really easily, and so they were able to sponsor him, and he was able to bring his whole family during the Guatemalan Civil War. So that's how they ended up there. He was just here working. But I think everyone that I know that came during that time first went to California and then ended up coming across the country. Yeah.
You know, I was wondering, as I was looking at the work, I was thinking you have a great sense of color and a great sense of pattern form. I could see that. And some of the works were the individual photographs, very thoughtfully constructed. And others were more family snapshots. Did you put them together for a particular reason in that way, thinking of one as the family album picture and another as more constructed, photographic, framed photograph? How do you think they work together for you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel like that I definitely want to have both of that in my project. I don't want it to just be one or the other. And I think both of those approaches interest me. Like, I like the still thing that I can, like, pause and, like, really compose, like, really well. But I also find that these moments, like my aunt cooking, that feels like it could have been taken, like, with a phone or something. It's just so much more quick and intimate. That also really interests me right now, maybe more than the other was. I also work with medium format film, and so that kind of presents some difficulties when I'm shooting in low light without a tripod and just, like, holding my breath, taking the photo. But yeah, I think I think both need to exist, for me at least, in my projects.
Mm-hmm. So what is a photograph? That's the question that comes up when I look at your work. What is a photograph?
What is the photograph? All of it?
Unanswerable, you know, but I wonder if you ever thought of that question.
Yeah, I mean, I think like so much more can be the photograph than what we're taught, you know? And I think, I don't know, photographs can be so much more than just the actual image that's composed, you know? I don't know if that makes any sense.
I loved hearing you mention this, like, kind of unlearning that you had to do after graduate school. And I think I understand that the school that you went through is, like, very book heavy. And I wonder if you could just speak a little bit more about the, like, 8 years post and how things have changed
since then. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, going to the Harper program, it's very book heavy, which is really amazing. I really appreciated, like, learning about that, that world. It's, like, it goes deep. but I think it's been really nice to, like, slowly give myself permission to do other work, especially, like, this piece, the video piece, because I still find, like, that also comes from photography. Like, these are images that I'm taking from Google Street View that I find that's also a photograph for me. And I feel like it's taken me this much time post that program to do things like that. And it's really exciting to, like, put this together and be like, oh yeah, this also makes so much sense to me. I also think that, like, the idea of having a project in an object that exists outside of the computer is something that's been very influential for me. And it's inspired me to create the zine project as well. And I still hold that. And I'm not entirely convinced. I don't want my project to be a photo book, but I'm still just, like, not sure. But in the beginning, like, post grad school, I think I wanted everything to be a photo book, and I felt like everything could be a photo book. But I'm realizing it doesn't always have to be.
You know, it's really interesting. You had this very personal project with your aunts and your grandmother and your family. And then I felt that the zines, it's almost like their departure away from that personal connection. Mm. It's fascinating the sort of the difference in your connection to those two bodies of work. And I was just curious, and I think it's really remarkable. Last week we also heard from a person who developed a group of Latino photographers in Boca. And then you come and you talk about bringing together people from Central America and the diaspora. I think that's really remarkable. And it's interesting, these two sort of flows of your work. And I'm curious where you want to go with the zine part of it.
Yeah, I think just seeing that it can exist as an exhibit, and I think it also, just creating the Laura Chata zine, I originally always wanted to be able to give money to all these artists that were submitting stuff to us. And the zine is self-funded. Like we every cent that we make from the sales of each zine gets put into the next issue. And there's just like nothing left over. It just like has continuously funded itself from the beginning. And we put in that little bit of money for the Xerox and the paper and the inks. And then from there, kind of just like funded itself. It would be nice to be more self-sustaining beyond that. Maybe even like pay ourselves for all our labor and also the artists as well. I think that that's something that I would really like to do. So, and I think at this point we've been at it for 5 years now. And for sure there's like we're at the crossroads of like, okay, like, is it going to become a business and we have to think about that, or is it going to be a nonprofit? Are we going to go that route, you know? Because I don't think it can keep existing in this very like haphazard way. And I'd like to give back more to the community.
Have you made a book of your work? The family oriented book?
I have not. I made a book for grad school, which is work that I didn't show today. But I haven't made a book of the other.
It just seems kind of interesting that you choose to have a body of work that's not in the book form, that's very personal. And then you do this more artful, I think, zine.
Yeah, I feel like I don't know if I always was this way, but I like hoard my photographs and I don't like talk about them or share them. But maybe it was just from grad school being burnt from that. But I feel like I've shared more of my illustrations, way more of that. I feel like sometimes I'm just known for that part of my artwork. So it's really nice to be able to talk about my photographs because I feel like it's not something I do often, but it's something I do every day. I make photographs every day. It's with my phone or something, you know? But yeah, this is something I've been thinking about for a while, especially with this project of my aunt's. I originally wanted it to be a book and I had this like very narrow, strict way that I was going to make it. But now I'm thinking about it, like maybe it'll be a video piece with a book also, you know? But it would be nice to be able to share that work in a book format where it can like go out into people's homes and you can spend more intimate time with it too in that way. Yeah.
So I always think of a book or a zine as being a very intimate relationship with a piece of art because you hold it and you take it home. And I wonder if a time-based medium like the videos that you're making, is your relationship to them different? They're all personal, but if you feel, what does a time-based medium bring you that's something that you have control over as opposed to me taking your zine home and I can do it helpfully?
Yeah, I feel like I could definitely have a bit more control over what I'm trying to say. It also, at least for this last piece, I was able to put it together pretty quick. Like I felt like I had the idea, I saw the vision and I put it together. And then because of social media, I was able to post it immediately and like have that instant gratification of like people seeing it, which is like really toxic, I think too. and you know, so there's that sort of like, it's an easier, I think also right now, virtually it's an easier way to share work through these shorts rather than stills. I feel like all of a sudden everyone's tired of looking at just a photograph on the internet, I feel like. And reels and videos and shorts are like what's in, and which is also a whole other thing. But I did feel really satisfied making this piece and it didn't take me that long because I felt like I was able to execute it really quickly. Whereas a photography project, I mean, I've been working on this project with my aunt since 2019 and it's like, I don't know. Who knows when it's going to be done? Maybe one day.
It seems like their story is still unfolding, right?
Yeah.
And you're have more of an observation, less of a question. It's interesting. I think like even your video, sort of, I can like see the bookmaker in you. Like they feel very like I could see them like as a flip book. I'm reading this book on Madrid right now. In the corner, I noticed there's like Rebecca Solnit snuck in like a little like what's it called, like a flip book of Moira's
like a stop motion
on the bottoms of the pages, and I could see like I could see your videos being incorporated into book format in interesting, fun ways.
Yeah, for sure. I feel like I can't I can't, like, it's almost like you get introduced to the photo book world and then you can never unsee it. Even if you think you're like, I'm making a video piece now. It's like, no, this is actually a book and fourth video piece. So, yeah.
Any questions?
Thank you. Thank you so much. We're going to take a little break just to get a coffee and shake our legs and get some air if you need it. We'll be back in like 5 minutes with Juan. Thanks, everyone.
Sarah, should I pat your back?
No, I'm good. I'm good. All right, Sadie. Sadie, you stay there, right where you are the whole time. All right, welcome back, everyone, and myself. We're going to start the second section of our Meet the Artist. I don't know if I introduced myself. My name is Sarah Danziger, if anyone. I think I know everyone at this point. Hi, I don't know you. So we're really excited to, I've been waiting for this presentation for a long time, so I'm excited. We've got Juan Madrid, and Juan Madrid is a photographer and book artist based in the Hudson Valley of New York. He earned his BFA in professional photographic illustration from the Rochester Institute of Technology and was the lab manager at the Center for Photography at Woodstock from 2015 to 2017. He has worked as a freelance photographer for clients including Vice, Bloomberg Businessweek, Topic, and Society Magazine in France, and teaches workshops centered around zine and bookmaking. He is one of the members of the publishing collective Los Sumergidos, whose first collaborative photo textbook, Los Sumergidos, was shortlisted at Photo España and Les Recontars. 2018. I'm going to let him take it away.
Just want to thank CPW for having me here tonight. And thank you, Sarah, for inviting. And thank you, Veronica, for sharing your work. And thank you all for being here. I'm going to jump right into new work. So I've been bouncing back and forth between photography since graduating college back in 2013. I've always been I have a very obsessive personality and was photographing like almost too much, I think, in college. But that carried over into after college. And back when I still shot film a lot more and had the money to just burn on it, I would just go out, walk, photograph, come back, scan, send out to get developed and then come back and scan and make prints of my photos on like a junky old laser printer that I picked up off Craigslist, but I converted it to third-party ink. I can make prints for like well under 25 cents. And I would just put stuff up on my walls, put stuff on tables, look at it, move it around. And just kept teaching myself more and more about sequencing photographs and looking at photographs next to each other. But like with most things, when you start doing them too much, you kind of get burned out. And while I was working at CPW and still photographing, I feel like I was just surrounded by too much photography. And it took a lot of the joy out of it in a lot of ways. And it's taken me like years of going in, stopping photographing for months, coming back, photographing like nonstop again. But I've started to find balance. And part of that was coming back to film photography and photographing kind of slow and also photographing digitally alongside it, but just taking things like just kind of day by day and just enjoying looking at things again. So all this work is shot on film. And this first one is a hill up in Troy, New York that I became obsessed with when I first saw it. It's really something to see in person, and it changes so much from morning to night, day to day, seeing people walking up it, seeing construction happening near it. So I've photographed it whenever I see it and something's like, oh, I need to photograph this hill. And I've always photographed trees and the Hudson Valley, and I've slowly begun to figure out what it is that fascinates me about the Hudson Valley. I grew up in Catskill, New York. Have lived here probably 3/4 of my life. And I'm just I've always photographed here. I haven't really photographed my family in like a really personal way. And I think the landscape in a way reflects on like what it felt like growing up here, what it still feels like to live here and see a lot of change happen, like even the last 2-3 years. And again, just finding joy in looking at things and playing around with light and seeing how you can make just a photograph. Like the question that was asked earlier, what is the photograph? It's like, for me, it's just something that's amorphous and kind of hard to really define. But when it clicks, it really like, it just, you know it. And it's also really funny to me because I've started making photographs that I probably never would have made in college. Like something like this, where it's just this really beautiful yellow bush. And it just doesn't have the pretense that comes with like going through college and you're going to crit every week and you have people giving you advice every which way. And it's kind of hard sometimes to like really just make photographs that you want to make, or that you see something, you're like, oh, I'm just going to make a photograph of this. Yeah, so these are all just those photos. And I'll just go through them. The hill popping up again. And it's also, for me, photography is like a game or a puzzle, but it's not a puzzle that's meant to be solved. I think if I ever did make a photograph where I felt like, oh, I made the photograph and I never need to make a photograph again, I'd feel really, really sad. But it's like this hill. I still have not made a photo of the hill that is the photo, and I probably never will, because what does that even mean? And I used to make a lot of portraits, but I kind of stopped sometime after college while still working at CPW. I just had a reckoning with it where when there was a lot of, in the photo world, there was a lot of stuff coming up in like journalism, in fine arts, where it's people coming into areas and photographing people that they didn't know, and telling stories that weren't theirs. It kind of just put me off it. And if I wasn't willing to like make a relationship with somebody to the point where I felt like I could make a portrait that felt authentic, then I probably shouldn't be doing it. Especially coming from, I went to school in Rochester, New York, where it's a Rust Belt city, a lot of blue collar people. And I would walk around and like actually get to know people. But there was still always a wall that you're not a part of their life, especially when you're holding a camera. And that's taken years for me to like just deal with and learn how I make portraits and how I feel comfortable making portraits, which I've been doing a little bit more over the past couple of years. I also never shoot black and white. I just don't like it. I don't like losing that control over having color, because I can always turn a photograph black and white. And I never learned how to develop or print in the darkroom in like high school or college. Yeah. But it also developed my vision for how I see too. So it's like, it's kind of sad, but it's also like, I wouldn't be the photographer I am today if I had done it. But I photographed in black and white for one of the first times since college, last winter or the winter before, I forget which. And it was actually it was really enjoyable, and it was just one roll, but it was a challenge. And I still think I shoot like a color photographer even when I'm shooting black and white. But I think that was actually the point in the past couple of years where I had that first jump start of like, oh, I actually enjoy making photographs again. Especially after seeing them in the negative and getting to scan them, and I was like, this is like really good. I can still make photographs. I can still go out and like shoot a roll, and most of it comes back really, really interesting to me. And this is like a body of work that's most likely going to end up being a collaborative zine with Veronica, who also shot a black and white roll at the same time. And it's that's another thing that I've really started to enjoy. And I think part of it was COVID, which all artists had to, anybody who made art had to contend with, is like all of a sudden you have time and space, but also you have to figure out different ways of working. And for me, I had just moved to the city before the pandemic started. And so it was like almost too busy to make work while I was there. And it was only 3 months. But then all of a sudden I had this immense amount of time and space to start making again. And I actually moved into video. I started making photographs again during the pandemic. But I started to collaborate more, which I'd always done through college, after college, but now it like became more of a focal point almost, just seeking community and trying to make things together, which I think is a really important way of working, because it can get you outside of your own bubble and outside of your own head. And this is just more new work, but this is all shot digitally. And this is that same hill, two different ways. And this, I'm primarily, I think of myself more as a book or a zine artist that uses photography. I also make photographs and I know how to make photographs, and I've looked at way too many photographs throughout my life to not call myself a photographer. But I'm way more interested in how do we put photographs together, mostly in books, but also just in like installation and other forms outside of screens, or outside of screens. So to books now, which I could talk about for days, but this was my first book, Waiting on the Dream, which was published by Vu Studio, who are now, they stopped publishing after 10 years. But they reached out to me after I submitted to one of their zines, zine open calls, and they chose my work. And then they asked me if I wanted to make a book with them. And it was like less than a year out of college. And I was like, this is not like, we've never been taught like you're going to get a book right out of college. And especially with a publisher that I feel like was a lot more mindful of the artists they worked with than a lot of publishers. Like they gave me copies. They were very open about collaborating and going back and forth about sequencing, material. They valued my opinion, which I've heard like a lot of horror stories from the book industry over the years. And they paid me, which that was like something I never had even considered. But they asked me about publishing my work from Flint, Michigan, which I'd spent 3 months there before my last year of college, and then like a month and a half, 2 months after college, just photographing and meeting people and trying to understand this city that had been left behind in the United States to just rot away. And coming from the Hudson Valley, and Rochester, it felt like a city that I knew already. Even though it was a little different. But that work became Waiting on the Dream, which is the red covered book. And then a couple years later, it was, I published this Welcome to Flint newsprint book, which is on the table over here, with my friend Brent Carlson, who had gone to RIT with me for college. And he had studied photojournalism while I studied art photography. And we thought it would be a really great idea to mix our two approaches to photography about this city to get a much broader understanding visually of what the city was. And this was before the water crisis too, which I think if we had gone there during it, it would have completely changed how we photographed and how people would have reacted to us. It wasn't the easiest getting to like know people sometimes. Brett as a photojournalist has a different methodology from me. So I would just walk around and hope people would talk to me, and it usually worked, but I feel like Flint, it was still a different city than any city I've been in. But that book on the right, yeah, Welcome to Flint, became this, and it was crowdfunded through Kickstarter back when Kickstarter was like still pretty young. And we just barely met our goal like towards the end of it. And then it was a year and a half process of working with a designer who we had also gone to school with. And I think was the first big collaboration that I was a part of. We got to go on press and see the entire process of what it means, what it is to make a book. Which it was also interesting as a contrast to the waiting on the dream, going from like a much more traditional photo book to like this thing that they just ran on traditional newsprint reels, and getting to see the machines up close and like getting ink on your fingers. And it also opened up how I saw the work. When you're working with somebody else's photographs and with a designer, it becomes a conversation that can be really hard to like toe the line of respecting everybody's work that's involved, but also keeping your own vision of something like as close to it as you can. And it depends on who you work with, how you work with them. Like working with a designer, she was pretty open to whatever we wanted. And it helped that we already knew her from college. But it was really fascinating to get to collaboration from that. And it really made it much easier, I think, for me in my artistic growth to continue collaborating. And I continued making books and zines since graduating college. Even my thesis, senior thesis show, I made it my first zine. And then just went kind of crazy from there. After the Flint books, which were much more traditional, like just utilizing photography, I've moved more towards mixing different medias, text and photo. The last 2 years, I've moved more towards collage. And I also like to call myself a visual language enthusiast, because I think how we see things as a culture, as different cultures, is really very rapidly evolving, almost to the point where it's hard to understand. Memes are a language that almost everybody can get from a split second of seeing something. And I've even found it crazy, like I'll see a meme that I have no idea of the context, but it feels like I know what somebody's saying to me. And so with a lot of my more current work, I've also tried to explore that, usually through collage. This is a spread of books from Miami Book Fair. I try and do a lot of book fairs and zine fairs. More, including installation on the right. And it's also, it's interesting to think of installation as a book as well. Like, how do you make a book into an installation? You know, we usually think of a book as something you have to turn a page, you have to read it. But why can't a wall be a book? And can it? Is it possible to turn a wall into a book? Or any other space. To talk a little bit about the books on the left, the zine posters, it's a publication called Sótano, which the collaborative group I'm a part of, Los Sumergidos, published 2 years ago, year and a half ago. But they're very satirical interviews by two anonymous interviewers who are trying to turn the photographer's interview upside down. They ask very asinine questions that end up going into very intimate conversations with the individual photographer of each issue. And it's also a fun way of looking at a book and trying to make it something more than a book. Like, this is a fold-out pamphlet poster, so you can finish reading it and then hang it up on your wall. It's also something that feels like inexpensive enough to where you could like share it with somebody, or if you forget it at like a coffee shop on a table, somebody else might pick it up and you might forget until one day you're like, oh, where is this publication? And it was a lot of fun to make. And I think that's something that I like to keep coming back to is, whenever I make art, I want to feel joy. And it's, what does it, what can you do to have joy when you're making something? And this is a book also published by Los Sumergidos, but designed and put together by another group I'm a part of, GOSH, which is a burgeoning nonprofit arts organization that's centered around building community and putting on events and making publications, but not focused on publications, and moving outside of photography. We have plans on working with a musician. One of our members is an illustrator and designer, and the other is a writer. So we come at it with a very different vision of like, what can we do to put everything together? And this book, these are the outside and inside covers of a book that was an essay by our writer member, mixed in with photographs by myself and his sister. And it's like the little cousin to our Los Sumergidos first book. An addendum where it's an essay where the writer comes to terms with masculinity and growing up in Texas as a brown man and growing up in a family of women and how that affected him and how he's changed as a person. And it was originally published digitally, and then in another effort of collaboration, we decided to make a book and a booklet, and it became a big, like, not a big, but it became like a very fun almost activity where they came up and worked with me up here in the Hudson Valley, and we had to figure out how to make these covers, and we tried like idea after idea, and we eventually just like built these like mini little sets and used my lighting kits to create shadows and try and bring up the essence of like what it means to grow up in the desert. And so the entire booklet goes from like from morning to night through using light and tone and color and design. And these are a couple other books. I designed the one on the right. It's called NYC Needs You, and it's a collection of DIY paper signs from New York City that get put up on light posts, on telephone poles. And an artist I know was collecting them, and I saw them, and I was like, we need to make a book together. And she very much wanted to, so we went back and forth creating this. And I think I actually forgot to bring it with me today, but it mixes between different things. Like, it starts out as just like a visual encyclopedia of these signs, and then starts going into like details, and then starts going into these crazy collages. And it's telling the story of New York through these signs, creating a portrait of something that's there. And it's also changing as New York City gentrifies. And the zine on the left is the first zine by GOSH, which is a mix of collage and text and QR codes, and trying to like play with the digital versus the physical and playing with paper. It's like, it's on the table. It's got a bubble wrap cover. It's got notes inside. And it's also a call to action. This idea of building community and how do you do it? Through zine making, through prompts, through like whatever you can in a very tangible physical form. And I also make zine, like I like to make zines for myself that never end up getting published. This one was for a small zine trade where I think I made 11 copies. And I was bored one day and I had to make this zine for the trade. And I took a dictionary I'd gotten from a thrift store. Noticed it had like these little images and illustrations and just started cutting it up and scanning it on my copier. And really liked the way it started playing with text and image and this idea of visual language and what it means. And it's also a dictionary that's way out of date at this point. But also it became more material for me, very in the moment of copying these images onto that and having the zine like just printed there. And that's what it was. Very freeing, very, very fun to just like to do, to come back to that whole idea of just having joy with what you make. And then I've been getting a little crazier and crazier with what I make, especially during the pandemic when I had a lot of time and I started getting into memes and conspiracies and like this whole history of all these things. And now with AI art starting to burgeon, I've made stuff like Arnold zine, which is a fanzine of Arnold Schwarzenegger. And I just wanted to, like, with the AI image generator one day, I was like trying to see what kind of crazy stuff I can make. And I thought this one was great because it's super grotesque, but you can't look away. And yet you could see this, like, it's the kind of thing you'd see and you'd immediately get it, but you'd also just be like, you don't know what's going on. And this is one of the collages that I've made, which similar to what the last slide I just showed. But alongside joy, I think, is one of my favorite things about making art is like learning things. A lot of my stuff is like not heavily research based, but I go down wormholes. So I pick up stuff off the internet. I get a lot of books from thrift stores that have images, biology books, science books. And I learn a lot of things. Like this skull is I forget his name, but it was a guy that had a pipe like that go through his skull, but he lived and his personality changed dramatically afterwards. Yes. Yeah. And so it's like stuff like that is really fun to like make a game out of it. This entire collage was about like learning and intelligence and like all these ideas that came together to make something that's not meant to be understood, but just sort of let you get lost in it and start thinking about things. And it also was when I started playing with AI more, that AI a little bit more. That background, I think, was Starry Night that I like ran through an AI generator two or three times until I got something that I thought was cool. And then I just wanted to come back around to one more body of work. This one is like, this one I started during the pandemic and it's still ongoing, off and on. It's changing a lot. It's I had to make photographs of like where I was, which was back at my father's house and my childhood home, after moving back from the pandemic. And it's always coming from like a working class family. My dad is an immigrant from El Salvador. I've always lived around some level of like of poverty and like the house kind of falling apart, but it's like gone way more by the wayside now, after my mother passed away 3 years ago. And now it's all just men living in this house. And my dad being an immigrant with very little education fixes things the way he fixes them, or kind of, he lets them go until you need to fix them and then has the most makeshift easy solution he can, that costs the least amount of money. But he's recently started to fix up the house, and so it's changing this work because it's been so focused on like capturing that sense that it's not the same anymore. But I think I have to actually start making photographs of that to understand where that's going. And these birds were actually really, really amazing because when I got back, when I moved back after the pandemic, I think it was the spring, that spring, they nested in our porch for the first time. Like, I can't remember during childhood or any time when I came back after college there being birds in there. But they nested and then they stayed for two seasons and had had little nestlings both times. And it was like actually really, really nice to just see them there and to see them change as it went by. That photograph on the left is probably one of my favorite photographs I've ever made. And it's like, it's a good photograph, but to see it in person was like something, something else. And it said, yes. So it had started, you can even kind of see like a little bit of water here. It had leaked around like where the gasket is. And rather than replace the head and like gasket and make sure it's sealed, he just taped it up with like black duct tape, and like he's got tape along the back to try and keep it from sinking. And yeah, it's this project is like this project was also like a form of therapy in a way, because I had to like sit down and like deal with understanding my own reactions to my father, and it changed my relationship to him, like helped me slow down more and not get frustrated when he does stuff like this. And also just being back home for such an elongated period of time after not living there as much. And then just Hudson Valley stuff, like you get bats in your house, we've got squirrels in the wall, like there's nothing you can do about it. You make photographs. And that's the last photograph.
When you talk about attempts to like turn the book into like a, I don't know, you can say like into an exhibition, but like can the wall be a book? How do you find like the relation between like a more than one wall or like an exhibition space and the book space? Or can you just speak to that a bit?
Did you say the delineation? Or did it?
No, just anything.
I think it depends on the situation. I co-curated an exhibition at CPW in Woodstock with Carlos Lord de Mola, who's right in the back, actually. Take a bow. Where it was an exhibition of zine makers and publishers, specifically about zines, called Common Senses. And it was like a multi-layered play on a lot of things. Common Senses, we figured... the pamphlet from like the Revolutionary War was like one of the first zines in the United States because it was passed around pretty freely or cheaply, and it was meant to incite like change. And that exhibition was mostly focused on artists of color and black artists, with a few white artists too, but it ended up being like 70 different makers, and it was one small like hallway in the former CPW. But it was two shelves lining the hallway, and then the walls decked out with different parts from books. And I think just that as an example of what to do, like with that situation, was sort of like the zines imploding and then exploding. So you're overwhelmed because it's like you've got hundreds of zines surrounding you every which way. For the opening night, we had a laser printer printing off like an artist edition of one of the zines. And then you've got like prints and ephemera on the wall. So it's like, it opens up the book and lets you appreciate it in a different way as you see an extension of what you're looking at. We also had book dummies from some of the artists, so you like get more of an insight beyond the finished product. So I think that's one way of looking at it. Like, we're usually given a finished product, but you can like start showing the process. You can start giving insight into different ideas that go beyond what you might see normally.
That's
still
amazing. Okay.
I still have the shelves because Hannah was gonna throw them away because she didn't have storage space.
It was packed. I never saw anything so packed. The
show was packed. We might have room for them.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
I had a question because you were saying, like, at the very beginning, you were saying you were really interested in installation. Is that, like, an example of what you're thinking about, like, how photographs and other photographic projects find a space to be for people to encounter them?
I don't really work in the realm of public art, but I'm very interested in that too. Like popping up installations somewhere, or working within a community too. Especially within local communities, like storefronts or stuff like that, where people might not also see art. I think when I was still in school in Rochester, there was like a pizzeria that would host local artists like once a month. All you had to do was email them and be like, hey, can you show some art? And they would sell it too, but the bigger thing was like just being able to show in a pizzeria. It's like somebody who might never see your work might see it and appreciate your photograph while they're biting down into a slice of cheese pizza.
So my first show was Musa.
Yeah.
The downside was that there was, I had a friend working there at the time and I came in to get pizza and she was like, that's real bad news. I was like, what do you mean? She's like, well, good news is someone really likes your work. Bad news is we found the empty frame behind the toilet. So I was like, damn.
That's also kind of the beauty of it too, though. Like, whereas a gallery space is usually kind of not, I don't want to say sterile, but like you're expected to act in a certain way. It's
Google.
Yeah, it's kind of, it's, that's kind of cool though. You had your work stolen from that. That reminds me of I was in a group show in Catskill one time called No Nudes, No Sunsets. And the whole premise was just, you can't submit any nudes and you can't submit any sunsets. And for the opening night, I went and took the one photo of Kim Kardashian when she like broke the internet and just some like alamy, database sunset and like pasted it on the back of the bathroom door. Yeah, because I think that's part of the whole thing I was talking about, having joy, having fun, is sometimes art just gets way too serious. Especially having worked like a lot of book fairs, people get very serious about what they make, and sometimes you just have to take a step back and have a breath and enjoy it and let other people enjoy it, even if it means they steal it from a bathroom.
I have a question. In terms of, I also really love like the democratic quality of being, but you know, just that it is a little bit of a rejection of like the higher art world. How do you feel about that in just like, is it a conscious rejection of keeping it to play, or is it like, well, this is what I can do?
It's definitely conscious for me. I could give a whole other talk on my ideas of American photography, photography in the United States that calls itself American photography. especially having gone to college at RIT, I was sort of like, can't think of the word, but like that was what was thrown at you. And so like there's just one history that you're taught, and it still like influences my work. But I think after college and after I got away from being taught that and being around a community that was like, oh, look at this, I sort of realized I can consciously work against it while still like letting it influence me in the ways it did. And of course, there have been different little events in my life that have led to understanding that more. I finally went to El Salvador for the first time in 2020, 2017 or 2018. And that was just a whole new experience, photographically and meeting family for the first time. I went with my dad, and that changed my photography and how I saw life. So, yeah, I kind of veered off from the question, but I didn't do
that. That's perfect. And I also just want to say that that picture of the closet is really made me think. And I think recognizing your dad is obviously an artist.
Yes, yeah, exactly. So my two friends who I'm in Gauche with, we've talked about that because the writer, Freddie Martinez, he stayed with me during the pandemic at my parents' house. And he also comes from like a more like blue-collar, working-class family background from South or West Texas. And he came into it pretty easily, but it was also just completely... Living with my dad is an experience in and of itself. It's a blessing and a curse. But when you look at it as he's an artist, it's like okay, that's pretty cool. He fixed the bathroom, so like that doesn't exist anymore, but I got to witness that, and I'm always a little glad that I have that photograph. We had joked that we should tear the wall out and like sell it as an art piece without telling him, and then like being like, hey, we sold the bathroom for $10,000. But unfortunately, we didn't even get a chance to try before we fixed it. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks everyone for coming. I just have a couple announcements. If you like what you see and you want to learn more about CPW, please sign up for our newsletter or follow us on Instagram. Michael Torres here, local photographer, is in a collective called Soul Reflections, and they have an opening this weekend at Unison Gallery in New Paltz at 68 Mountain Road from 4 to 6 p.m. So if you're interested in more photography made in the area by a local artist, that's your stop. Brian, anything else? We have more exciting things coming. Just stay in touch. Thanks, everyone. Thank you, Veronica, and thank you, Juan.